Yes. I'm over here having church for sure. Good morning. I'm Sherry Verdonk.
And I am Mariama Whalen.
It is our honor to welcome you to Davies Unitarian Universalist Congregation, a community of different people, different beliefs, and one faith. Joining me in leading worship this morning are Rick Peralta, our music director. In a unique quartet service, Joyce, Daniel, Mariama, and I will serve as today's worship leaders and associates. As a committee that is composed of more than the four of us, we're just a subgroup, the Eighth Principle Committee have spent the last couple of months engaged in discussions and teachable moments about intersectionality, a term coined by Dr. Kimberly Williams Crenshaw. I will go into more detail on her change impact later on in the service. In remembrance of one of this nation's most vocal BIPOC and women activists, Sojourner Truth, Mariama and I will officially begin the Eighth Principle Committee's intersectionality service with her words, shared from the popular version of the infamous speech, "Ain't I a Woman," delivered in Akron, Ohio in 1851. Well, children, where there is so much racket, there must be something out of kilter. I think that twixt the Negroes of the South and the women at the North, all talking about rights, the white men will be in a fix pretty soon. But what's all this here talking about?
That man over there says that women need to be helped into carriages and lifted over ditches, and to have the best place everywhere. Nobody ever helps me into carriages or over mud puddles or gives me any best place. Ain't I a woman? Look at me. Look at my arm. I have plowed and planted and gathered into barns, and no man could heed me. Ain't I a woman? I could work as much and eat as much as a man when I could get it and bear the lashes well. And ain't I a woman? I have borne 13 children and seen most of all of them sold off to slavery. And when I cried out with my mother's grief, none but Jesus heard me. And ain't I a woman? Then they talked about this thing in the head. What they call it? They call it intellect. That's it, honey. What's that got to do with women's rights or Negroes' rights? If my cup won't hold but a pint and yours holds a quart, wouldn't you be mean not to let me have my little half measure full? Then that little man in black there, he says women can't have as much rights as men because Christ wasn't a woman. Where did your Christ come from? Where did your Christ come from? From a God and a woman. Man had nothing to do with him. If the first woman God ever made was strong enough to turn the world upside down all alone, these women together ought to be able to turn it back and get it right side up again. And now they asking to do it. The men better let them. Obliged to you for hearing me. And now, old Sojourner ain't got nothing more to say. I will now share our extended platform with Joyce to light the chalice.
As Sherry and Mariama light our Davies chalice, I invite you to consider these words from Don Summers' title, A House of Our Dreams. We, all of us, build houses for our dreams. The masonry and lumber, glass and tiles, a solid form wherein we see our hopes, a shelter and protection for our growth. This house shall be a dwelling place for courage, for integrity, for love, engendered, nourished by a family that speaks of we and means all humankind. These walls shall represent the privacy and dignity of individuals, the open doors, a welcome to all people, all ages and all generations. The windows shall keep light of inquiry, illuminating from outside and within. May all words spoken here be born of love and energy, rekindle in the hearts of those who dreamed this house, who plied the tools and paid the price to actualize the dream. May dreaming never cease for those within who know the world to be a troubled place, but dare to struggle with imperfectness toward that brighter hope, that better day. Let memories add warmth, a heritage, a quilted patchwork stitched with history of kindliness, of daring for the good, of funny moments, jokes and smiles and tears. This is a precious place as every home that shelters those who love and strive and share. Its blessing is in lives that meet within, in living, learning, caring, sheltered here.
Thank you, Sherry and Joyce. As we enter this hour of worship and community, let us take a breath. And family, another. Let us be mindful this morning of the land where our beloved sanctuary stands. Let us be mindful of the Piscataway who have walked these hills for 800 years and more, and who remain an integral part of our community. Let us remember those who were enslaved and worked this land without choice or reward, and whose descendants are with us today. Let us remember the untold number of people who have lost their lives in the four centuries of racial violence and murder that continue to shape this nation and its people.
Let us remember all those impacted by COVID-19, those we have lost, and the family and friends who now feel their absence in their lives. We remember, too, those struggling with the illnesses themselves and those struggling with its after effects. Let us hold in our hearts with gratitude all those who are working to end the pandemic, those who keep us fed and connected, those working in hospitals and testing sites, those doing all they can to distribute and administer vaccines in the midst of a pandemic. Let us hold in our hearts these solemn remembrances and these prayers of gratitude as we join Rick and Alana in singing hymn 149, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Our reading this morning comes from an excerpt from Marche Greer, 2018 UU World article titled, Getting Intersectional Means Showing Up When There Are No Pink Hats. When the original organizers of the Women's March, who were white women, added three organizers of color, and the Women's March added aspects of an intersectional framework to its platform, many believed both mainstream feminism and the march organizers had made an important turn toward being more intersectional. While it is significant that women of color are key figures in such a large movement, their presence has given mainstream feminists permission to assume that their work as becoming intersectional is done. It's not. Relying on the presence of women of color or any group of women further marginalized beyond gender to show that their interests are represented is not activism, it's tokenism. It communicates to women who are further marginalized at the intersections of their gender that their other marginalizations will be considered worthy of advocacy only if they advocate for themselves.
For feminist spaces to truly be intersectional, this can no longer be the model. It's no longer good enough to look at feminist groups that were birthed out of the Women's March and assume because various groups of women are represented in membership that their interests are also represented in advocacy. This type of inclusivity is merely symbolic. The presence of a person alone does not mean the full breadth of their humanity is honored. Only speaking out when one has skin in the game is not activism, it's self-preservation. If feminism is going to get truly intersectional, women of privilege, let me say that again, women of privilege have to start showing up when an event or an action isn't about them. Listening to what marginalized women want them to amplify and being allies beyond when it only benefits them. Kimberly Williams Crenshaw is an African-American lawyer, civil rights advocate, philosopher, and scholar of the now hot button topic, critical race theory. Kimberly Williams coined the phrase intersectionality after working with the feminist movement and recognizing the crossroad of discrimination faced by Black women who suffered a double dose based on race and gender. She spoke this phrase into existence in 1989 as a means to describe how race, class, gender, and other individual characteristics intersect with one another and overlap. However, since then, intersectionality has gained traction as we have become more aware of how race, ethnicity, gender, age, and ableism intersect and are cast aside when previously defined boxes cannot be checked. We are not purely defined by one characteristic, and the more hats that you wear governs how you move with and through society. Intentional intersectionality, according to some, has several components. These are applied in the workplace and in most social situations where discrimination and bias can flourish. Critically speaking, one must first recognize the multiple facets that comprise individuals, each holding their own unique disadvantages and challenges. Each one should be honored in safe spaces. Each aspect should be acknowledged for the stereotypical bias it generates. Intersectionality has become a point of contention in the United States. The debate is among academics who want clarification of Dr. Crenshaw's intent, activists who seek to eliminate disparities of the term as it relates to systemic racism, and the right who argue on how activists use them. Born out of critical race theory, Dr. Kevin Minifu, a former student of Dr. Crenshaw and postdoctorate research scholar at the African American Policy Forum, remarked that Dr. Crenshaw's understanding of intersectionality is not really concerned with shallow questions of identity and representation, but more interested in the deep structural and systemic questions about discrimination and inequality. I will now extend the platform for Daniel to share a few words.
Today, I will share briefly the loss of three lives at the intersection of oppressions. Michelle Cousseau was a 50-year-old woman living in Phoenix, Arizona. Michelle suffered from bipolar disorder and schizophrenia. On the afternoon of August 14, 2014, after a cab she had called failed to arrive, Michelle called the behavioral health provider Southwest Network for assistance. A manager at Southwest Network found Michelle's comments to be threatening and called the Phoenix Police Department. Michelle refused to let four PPD officers into her apartment upon their arrival. When the police began attempting to remove the security door to her apartment, Michelle opened it holding a hammer. A white police sergeant shot Michelle at point blank range in the chest, killing her. An internal review by the PPD found that the sergeant's actions had violated department policy, but the officer was only demoted in rank. Would this have happened if she had been a white woman? Michelle Cousseau, say her name.
Michelle Cousseau.
Dominique Remy Fells was a 27-year-old transgender woman who was brutally murdered and dismembered. Her remains were discovered alongside the Schuylkill River in Bartram's garden area of Philadelphia on June 8th, 2020. Remy was a dancer and an artist and had plans of going back to school to become a fashion designer. Roland Williams, Remy's uncle, said of her that she was great at sewing, great at taking old clothes and making them into something fashionable for her. The sky was the limit. Unfortunately, her life was cut short. According to the Human Rights Campaign, at the time of Remy's death in 2020, there were at least 13 violent deaths of transgender or gender non-conforming people in the United States. Transgender women of color represent the majority of those deaths. Why do transgender women of color comprise a majority of these fatal attacks? Remy Fells, say her name.
Remy Fells.
Vicha Ratanapakti. He came from Thailand to care for family. Weary of being cooped up inside during the pandemic, Vicha was impatient for his regular morning walk. He washed his face, put on a baseball cap and face mask, and told his wife he would have the coffee she had prepared for him when he returned and stepped outside. About an hour later, Mr. Vicha, an 84-year-old retired auditor from Thailand, was violently slammed to the ground by a man who charged him at full speed, the type of forceful body blow that might have knocked unconscious a young football player in full protective pads. For Mr. Vicha, who stood 5'6" and weighed 113 pounds, the attack was fatal. He died of a brain hemorrhage in San Francisco hospital 2 days later. Antoine Watson, a 19-year-old resident of neighboring Daly City, was arrested 2 days after the attack and charged with the murder and elder abuse. He has pleaded not guilty, but his lawyer admits that his client had, quote, an outburst of rage. Mr. Veach's family described his killing as racially motivated, and it spurred a campaign to raise awareness by many prominent Asian Americans who used the online hashtags Justice for Vicha and #StopAsianHate. Would Mr. Vicha have been attacked if he was less vulnerable or a different race? Mr. Vicha, say his name.
Mr. Vicha.
I will now extend the platform to Mariama to share a few words.
When understanding intersectionality, it may be helpful to couple the layers of marginalization with systemic framing. For example, remembering the 1991 sensational drama and victimization of Anita Hill, when she was subpoenaed to appear before Congress and share her truth and experience as a victim of then nominated Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas. Hill's gender, race, class, and educational attainment were under attack in order to subvert and divide communities that insisted on civil rights, inclusivity, and diversity. Each of Hill's layers were unjustly and forcibly scrutinized as she told the world how sexually perverse and assaulting Clarence Thomas was as her supervisor. The grounding of Ms. Hill's persecutions were located within the halls of her former employer, the Department of Education, within the lecture halls of the University of Oklahoma College of Law, within the chambers of the United States Senate, and even within sanctuaries of the Black Church. Subjected to fabricated diagnoses such as delusion, spurned, and sex revenged, Hill is recognized as a modern day intersectionality case. One that Dr. Crenshaw uses to show how intersectionality can negatively impact the life of a person when their worth is only defined by biological characteristics. Characteristics that society has constructed to be less than, worthless, vile, or simply not good enough. The work of the Eighth Principle Committee seems never ending and at times exhaustive. However, as a community of different people, different faiths, and one belief, it is our calling to be change agents, to persistently identify the wrongs that privileged society calls right. Many of us in this room can testify on how and when our intersectionality has played a part in denied opportunities that we would otherwise qualify for. Today's message ends with a call for change, a call for action that addresses sadly the incessant melee of pushback, claw down, and lockout. We challenge you to join the conversations that focus on the BIPOC community and our daily challenges to revolt the everyday messages that we are not good enough. We call each of you to participate in the work of the Eighth Principle. We call every committee in the congregation to plan and monitor their own Eighth Principle objectives. And lastly, we ask how long will it take for the Unitarian Universalist Association to adopt the Eighth Principle? How long? Not long, because no lie can last forever. How long? Not long. You shall reap what you sow. How long? Not long, because the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. Ashe. Assalam and blessings.
Yes, yes, yes. I invite us now into a period of reflective silence. Let us enter into that period of silence together. Amen. I'm over here in the sanctuary having church, looking at Rick and going, having church all by myself right here in this room. Anyway. As we extinguish the Davies chalice and move toward our shared benediction, I invite you to join me in the spirit of prayer and contemplation as we consider these words from Molly Brewer from A Prayer for Me Too. Spirit of life and of love, Holy One that reaches wide to encompass all beings, hold us to yourself in this moment. We come to this place carrying so much in our hearts. Around us, we hear the laments of a broken world, torn by fire, storm, and strife, crying, I too have suffered. I too have been hurt and oppressed by power, by pain, by loss, and by neglect. We open our ears and lift up the words of all who join in this sorrowful song. Me too, Spirit, comfort us.
Descend around us as a cloud of peace and compassion. Abide with us in our mourning. Help us to gather ourselves to face each day with bravery and equanimity, or even just to face it at all. Help make each movement lighter, less laden. Give us the grace to once again give thanks and the strength to be kind to ourselves over and over. One day, may our cries of shared sorrow give ways to songs of joy. May we sing, I too am healing my broken heart.
Yes.
I too see the faces of justice and mercy. I too am filled with light, love, and compassion. Me too. Me too. Blessed be and amen.
While we can't circle the sanctuary and hold hands this morning, we can rejoice together. We can rejoice in the fact that we have come together in this beloved, ever-evolving community. I invite you to fold your hands in prayer, lift them to the light, or place them on your heart as Rick leads us in our closing benediction. You'll find the words posted in the chat room.